How amazing is that? If you are one of the few who has not seen that first appearance on this show almost 4 years ago now, definitely do yourself a favor and check it out. It's on YouTube. It's amazing to go back and just see how he's exactly the same person, perhaps a little louder now, a little more brash, but really it's the same guy. And the man behind the man is John Kavanagh, and he is joining us in studio. So kind to be here with us once again. It has become a tradition, and usually you're very tired in Las Vegas after the fight. This time you're in studio. What a pleasure. It's such a great honor to have you here. So first off, thank you and congratulations on the big win.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me back.
Wow, amazing. How do you put into words what you witnessed on Saturday? I mean, every step of the way, I feel like I keep asking you about history. Yeah. They continue to get bigger and better, but this was MSG. This was the two titles. This is what you guys worked for. Can you even put it into words?
I don't think so. I think it's like when girls tell you, describe your feelings.
Yeah.
If you could, they'd be called talkings, not feelings.
And yes.
This is just something you just had to see. And if you were there in the night or even just watching it live, it was very, very special.
How does it compare to Aldo, to Diaz 2? Does this one feel better than all of them? Does this feel more special than all of them?
The Diaz 2 was a very special fight as well, you know. But not just for the victory, but like you said, it's context. You know, to feel you're doing the same walk Ali did, you know, the fight Frazier, just got goosebumps. And like I said to you, I made a point, which I normally don't do, of forcing myself to really take in the event and look around and really try to enjoy every moment of it.
Yeah, obviously I noticed that because you seemed very happy all week. You even showed up to the post-fight press conference, which I've never seen you do.
Never have.
Was it because it was MSG?
Yeah. I said to you, I wasn't going to let anything slide on this particular one because it's a one-off, and I don't, like, you know, back in the day, let's say, BJ Penn and Randy Couture have held two belts, but not simultaneously.
Exactly.
But even that, I don't think you can do that anymore because the skill level is just so high now.
Right.
You know, for someone to try and win two belts now, I think is near on impossible. So I don't think you'll even see two belts being held, not simultaneously, you know, in two different weight classes, but to have them both held simultaneously in the first event in New York, you know, in the MSG, like it goes on and on and on. So it's, I was going to take in every moment.
I want to almost start chronologically here. And let's start Thursday with arriving once again late to the press conference, you know, the jacket, everything that was said, almost the melee, so to speak. And you know him better than anyone. And you know when, you know, he's putting on a show, and I don't think you're ever worried about him. But was there ever a moment where it was like, okay, we need to sort of focus. We need to rein it in here. This is getting a little too crazy.
I feel I'm asked this question every fight.
This one seems
he's losing it. You gotta get him under control, and I always have the same response. If the results he's getting are him losing it, well, keep losing it. You know, he knows what he's doing.
Yeah,
he's well able to differentiate between a press conference and the start of a fight. You know, it's a very different mindset. I mean, look at him again.
Yeah,
watch when he's walking out, and watch when the fight begins. Look at how efficient, how little unnecessary movement there was. So there's the craziness of a press conference, which, I mean, it's why they put them on now, right?
Sure.
For him to put on somewhat of a show. Even the fake weigh-ins thing, I did tweet before it.
I couldn't agree more, by the way.
Yeah, I've tweeted before. I don't really see the point anymore because it just, like, you've done them in the morning and you just want your day to be rest.
Yeah.
You know, and as a coach, it's a gift we have now that by 10 a.m. you're beginning the rehydration process. After the weigh-ins, I retweeted that, okay, I see what it was about because it was amazing, you know? But is there another fighter that would have a weigh-in like that where you get that number of people showing up and that kind of feel? Is there a number fighter that will put on a press conference that gets that kind of, whether positive or negative, feedback? I don't think there is. So it's something sort of unique around him.
Do you feel like he feels pressure to keep outdoing himself at these press conferences? Because it's almost become, I mean, they could charge like $4 for it.
And I heard the weigh-in tickets were being sold.
Yes. They gave them out for free, but then a lot of people sold them like on eBay and stuff. And people, I met a guy from Kazakhstan who paid $80 a ticket.
I met a guy who paid $200.
That's insane.
To watch a guy on his underwear.
And there's no entry because they have already weighed in. It's really just to see them square off.
Just to see them square off.
You feel like he now, I'm guessing not, but do you get the sense that, like, he has to keep topping himself now because there's so many expectations?
You know the answer.
Yeah, he doesn't.
He enjoys this. I mean, watch the video back there you just showed. That's 3 years ago. And I could, if we had had this kind of, not technology, but videos of him promoting, like when he fought on my show, if we had done some interview 10 years ago, it would be the same. It has never changed. So it's like asking somebody, do you ever get tired of being you? You're just being you right now. I'm the way I am. He's the way he is.
Okay. So then we get to Friday and he weighs in, and by all accounts, a successful weigh-in, you know, it was an easy cut.
Overshot it. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean,
he's actually 154 when we checked, and then, you know, he's able to sip water and he went up to 154.4.
Obviously not as easy as making 170, no. But this, I'm assuming, other than those two fights, the easiest one in the UFC.
Yes, definitely. Yeah.
And what a pleasure, right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I've said it. Someone actually tweeted me something I thought was quite good. They said I should have got a picture where Orla with a belt either side on her eating porridge, and see, get the Goldilocks reference. Like, yes. You know, just right. Not too hot, not too cold.
Yes.
Drifted off.
How easy it was.
Oh, sorry. It's not easy.
Okay.
But it's definitely easier. But I do like that it is. I always tell my fighters when they're cutting weight that they send fighter pilots out hungry because it sharpens senses, you know. And I think when you have to make a weight, you know, and you just have to make that weight, there's something it does to you in that 7 day run in that, you know, just everything gets very, very focused and serious. And I kind of like it.
But all of a sudden on Friday, we took a left turn because he was, you know, starting fights with everyone else not named Eddie Alvarez. And the best part about it was you in the background in every single shot, just standing there with a smile on your face, not flinching, not worrying, just almost taking it in like this observer at the zoo. You were just enjoying it. You had no worry. You had no care in the world. You just don't feel like you need to get involved, right?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. Like people, oh, he sees the camera, you know, just people standing between them. Shout out to Wonder Life there and Boars. I seen you writing that.
Who's that?
I'm only kidding.
Okay.
He's a good guy.
Okay.
But anyway, the point I was going to make was, like, I could tell you stories of us being in small shows in Ireland. There was, you know, one stands out in particular where he almost got into a fight with the guy's coach as we were warming up. And it's a small, you know, very small show in Ireland that no cameras around. So just the cameras weren't there.
Yeah.
But I don't think I've been to a show where there wasn't nearly a fight with somebody else. So at this stage, I just go with it. If something happens, it happens, but it rarely does.
You're enjoying it. Okay. And then, so, you know, we obviously get to the fight, and last week on this show, you said, what was it? 8 minutes in, right? Third minute of the second round.
And
you were 4 seconds off.
And if you want to get really technical, he had knocked him down at the,
you know what? I went back and watched it. Almost exactly.
No, it was. 7:59:8.
That's unbelievable. But I have to say this, we almost kind of thought that the fight was going to go completely different. I mean, he didn't do the wrestling, he didn't do the clinch. You were saying that he was going to get tired, the arms were, it was a completely different fight. What are you thinking as you're seeing in the first round? He's not doing the Anthony Pettis fight. He's just standing there. What are you thinking?
You know, it's one thing when you're in the gym and you're coming up with game plans and you know, you're executing certain things in a gym environment. What really makes Conor stand apart, and any coach will tell you this, is how calm and how his technical ability in that pressurized environment, millions watching, and everybody, you know, he is the heel somewhat. You know what the story does.
It's great.
People want to see him lose. You know, it's like Ali used to say back in the day, your puppy fell out there.
Oh, no.
Ali used to say back in the day, he didn't care if people were tuning in to watch him get his ass whooped as long as he bought the ticket, you know. And it's the same with Conor. But anybody interested in sports science or sports psych will say how near on impossible it is to get an athlete to perform in that environment as they were performing in the gym. And within the opening seconds, I just seemed to be, I could hear their corner, like, seemed to panic, like just screaming all sorts of things. We're in the first opening 15, 20 seconds.
You can hear this?
It was so loud. I mean, you know, they're only 30 feet across.
Sure.
And he seemed to be kind of almost talking to them, and it just looked like disarray. And in my head, I was thinking, this is going to go bad fast. And it's another...
Bad for him.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's another example of, again, the difficulty of transferring what you might have done in the gym to this type of environment. And it's something no one will understand until they actually face him. That even being in the corner against him can rattle people. Like, you know, obviously his corner are excellent and experienced, and they seem to be fall apart a little bit. And his game plan seemed to go out the window a little bit. Now, of course, he got tagged within 60 seconds badly, and it was incredible, his recovery.
Yeah. Did that surprise you that he was?
Oh, I couldn't believe it.
Yeah,
it was like an accordion. He went, you know, and he actually went, nope, like this. And I was going, I had a flash in my head of like, oh, it's another zombie. Hmm. It's going to be one of these guys that, you know, kind of Nate, you know, just continue walking forward. But then obviously what happened happened.
Are you surprised that I think he went for one takedown in the second, none in the first? Do you just think that the moment got to him?
No, like it's different when you're facing Conor and his stance, and like people will tell you that, like I'm maybe you could ask Eddie, like you don't really see the opening for the takedown. Hmm. Yeah, and there's the worry that you're going to run into a knee, or you know, Weidman had got such a bad knee, put his head down, you're going to run into an uppercut, or what's it going to be? So it's one thing again in the gym environment, and then when you're out there and you're facing him, and I don't care who you've brought in, they're not going to mimic him correctly, or and add in all the psychological elements as well. So just the opening wasn't there, and then any he did looked really not very high level, just how easily he was brushed off.
Right.
Obviously in the second now he had a much closer attempt, he had good position on defense, but that's their position.
By the way, guys in the back, if we can just change the screen over there, the logo is missing. That kind of thing bothers me. I'm a stickler for those things. I said it at the top of the show, it's amazing to me, but I truly believe this. I truly believe that his opponents and their teams, their coaches, are still underestimating him, mm-hmm. are still not giving him the credit that he deserves when they're preparing for him. They still don't respect his skills.
Yeah.
And it's one thing to say it in the interviews, which I actually think is a stupid thing to say, because if you're putting down your opponent and then you lose to him, well, then what does that say about you? But I still believe in the preparation. They're like, nah, he's been, you know, coddled. He's been, you know, protected by the UFC. Do you get that sense as well that they still don't respect him?
I think it's more talk. I've no doubt that these guys did whatever they could in training. I'm sure they killed themselves. You know, you see Eddie 8 days out, you know, black eyes and sparring hard. So I'm sure the work was put in. I just think it's a major surprise to them when the first shot lands, or you know. But to be honest, like, and I was thinking about how am I going to say this, because I know it'll be taken out of context, and it's absolutely no comment on Eddie's personality as a person. He seems like a great guy, solid fighter, but if we're just looking at skill sets, I felt going in, and it was a little bit my reasoning to be able to take in the week, that this was a massive mismatch. And again, that's nothing to say about him as a person, I'm just saying in skills wise I really felt this would look worse than the Brimage fight, but that style of fight where he just would be always too late, always getting hit, fall apart. I did think his toughness would take him into the second round, which it did. But skill set wise, I just thought it was a massive mismatch. And I will humbly offer the evidence of the fight as being warranted that. And all of our sparring partners, all the people back home, we all saw this, just thinking, this is going to be a bad fight. This is going to look terrible. You know, whereas Nate was so interesting because of the style-wise and size-wise, not massive size difference, but enough to make it interesting, enough to offer new problems.
Yeah.
But this one, an orthodox, head-down kind of brawler with a sort of simple style of wrestling, not very complicated. I just felt you have to bring a hell of a lot more of that to the plate to trouble what I think is the best fighter on the planet right now. And that's how the fight played out, so I think it's backed up. But I don't think it mattered what they did in the gym. I actually saw when they start talking about, oh, we're learning new skills, you know, dealing with the rock back and all that, I actually thought that's a major mistake, because you can't learn a new skill in 4 weeks. Mm. New skills take 4 months or a year. Anybody in sports science will tell you that. So you're better just sticking with what you already know, but make it better. So when I saw them doing kind of new pad work drills and trying to learn new movements, I knew that would actually even cause worse problems, because then you're in the fight and you
get thinking.
Technique. Yeah, you're thinking. Mm. You can't think in a fight. Mm. You have to just do, and you'll only do what's already ingrained into you. But if you've learned something 2 or 3 weeks ago and you're, what was that move again? Bang. Oh, shit. Oh, bang. Mm. Okay. Panic. Bang. You know, things get very bad very fast.
Is that part of the reason why you didn't necessarily say this last week, but you did say that you pushed him to do this? You wanted him to have this moment on the stage. But given who the opponent was that part of the thinking as well? If it was a different opponent?
Certainly number one.
Yeah.
The event.
Yeah.
It's MSG. It's the first. We've said this something times now, but that's definitely number one. And then number two, I just did think stylistically that it's going to be a really terrible day.
Hmm. That four punch combination that finished him. I mean, what a thing! It's almost like watching like a like pinball. You know, pinball. Boom, 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 boom. Amazing to land flush with every punch.
Incredible. Watching it back in slow mo, like the pinpoint accuracy.
Yes, he's like a sniper.
Yeah.
He does. What I appreciate most about him as a fighter, and I know people are going to be like, "Oh, you're fawning over Conor." We cannot do anything but fawn over Conor today. There's nothing to take away from him in terms of his skill and his promote everything. So I have to fawn over him because he's just that damn good. He doesn't waste any punches. It's never like throw two that you're going to miss and then you'll get him with the third. Every one means something. And that, I mean, that sequence right there is a perfect example of that. Is that particular for punch combos?
Yeah, I mean, I would certainly say to any young fighter, like, watch everything in that fight because there's no wasted punches, but there's no wasted movement. Like,
right.
Every step is for a reason. Like, every feint is for a reason. Every movement of his eyes is for a reason. It was funny. I spoke to Dee afterwards. We watched the fight back and I was like, I really enjoyed that because it was quite a beautiful fight. Like, I think it was Ali. I remember somebody saying like, a fighter is always trying to chase the perfect performance, you know, where everything just went right. And I said to her that, you know, that fight was just quite technically beautiful to watch. And I said, but I guarantee you Conor's going to slay it. And sure enough, the next night we're watching it and he just berated, you know, not berated, but he was just pulling apart different moments. Nah, I shouldn't have done that. I should have done this. And da-da-da-da. And I was like, you know, me and her were kind of throwing our eyes up laughing, like, you know, but that's, you have to be like that. You have to be, well, some people might say bordering insanity and on demanding extreme perfection from himself. How else are you going to push yourself to be that perfect?
Right.
You know, because I really think he could probably do a lot less and still be able to beat most of these guys, but he's not trying to beat them. He's trying to beat himself. He's trying to be the perfect fighter for himself. And that's what I've seen since day one. But yeah, I mean, you could take down the fans, the four punch combination that finished it, the shot selection on how he's dropping at the beginning, the head over the lead leg, pulling and his pullbacks, his, everything in that fight was just gorgeous.
So for the record, was there anything that you didn't like about the fight? About his performance?
You know, I was finding it hard to pull out a few points, but he had a number of points.
What bothered him most?
It's
okay, you can say. No one's watching, no one cares.
You know, even say on the first knockdown that he, if you watch the last knockdown where as he approaches, he gently guides the feet to the side and then boom, boom.
Yeah.
He didn't do that the first time and kind of caught up in the guard a little bit. So he was very hard on himself about that. And one or two other little things that just, like I said, he's so demanding of perfection. It's, you know, a coach is supposed to be like that.
Yeah.
And I'm almost the one saying, oh, you did great, you know. But like, as I said, it's a special quality and that's what makes him who he is, that he is that hard on himself. And it's a great bar to set for my other guys, you know, because they're all watching him going, shit, he's not happy with that.
Yeah.
He's still the one. First in the, well, not maybe not first in the gym, but certainly last one out.
That's right.
And it's great because they, you know, you'll always measure yourself against what's best in your gym.
Right.
And my guys have such a high bar to aim for, which, you know, makes my job a little bit easier that they're the same kind of on themselves and everybody's so hard on themselves about trying to be perfect in everything we do.
One of the fun talking points after the fight, our own Esther Lynn, our photographer, got this great photo of him.
She's
from
a great
the back
photographer
with the hands behind his back. And then Artem tweets out a picture of them clearly at SPG, clearly sparring. At some point he's doing the exact same thing. So this is something that he actually did.
Yeah.
Like this was part, not part of the game plan, but did he do this often?
Yeah, he damaged his index knuckle.
Okay. In the DS fight?
In the DS fight.
Okay.
And it kept getting jarred.
The right hand, right?
The right hand.
Yeah.
It kept getting jarred. And it's one of those things, it was just not enough to pull out of a fight, but it's just bugging him the whole time. And Conor does a lot with his lead hand, whether it's lead hand fighting or good jab or, you know, whatever. But he found that if he actually held his lead hand behind his back, it kind of reminded him not to throw it as much.
Wow.
So that's why he started reaching back and actually grabbing his hand. You see it in both pictures, he's grabbing the same hand and then using the left hand a bit more or using the right hand more sparingly. It was almost like a mental note. Take care of the right hand.
Wow.
And then, you know, it happened in the fight. Then.
That is amazing. So he's not necessarily trying to get under his opponent's skin, but it kind of works both ways, right?
It works both ways.
Yeah.
And when someone hasn't got the kind of, like I always used to think like back in the day, like, okay, we can't, the Americans are probably going to have better wrestling than us because you just have the wrestling programs from youth.
Yeah, yeah.
But we have is boxing from youth. And I sort of see the kind of grapplers that are learning how to box they only have a couple of years of it, whereas Conor has a lifetime of it. And there's so many subtleties. Like a very easy one I can say is, if you put your hands down, an untrained person will try to swing at your head because it's a base instinct. I want to punch the guy in the head. So it's almost like I always said that I believe striking is a high risk, high speed game of probability. You actually fight on probability rather than reactions. Probability wise, if I drop my hands and lean in with my head, you're probably going to swing your right hand at me. Hmm. That just happens 9 times out of 10. It'd be unusual for someone to do that and a person to throw a jab to the body, for example, which would actually be a better option.
Right.
So if you have a very high level of striking, of boxing like Conor does, you understand rules like that. And there are many of them. And I don't think others are kind of catching up to that level of skill. As we are maybe, a little bit behind on the intricacies of wrestling. We're maybe a little bit ahead on the intricacies of striking.
What's the first thing that you said to him when he went to the corner? Do you even remember? I know it was so loud as pandemonium, but do you recall what you said to him?
I think I just said yes, 2-weight world champion.
Wow. Did you say the same thing when he won the Cage Wars lightweight title?
God, I won't remember that.
There's been a lot.
I won't remember that.
when you notice, when as a team you notice that they forgot the second belt or didn't have the same, I was noticing him, he was very upset before they even announced him as the winner, and you could tell, and I was like, it's clear, because he had talked about that moment over and over. He wants that picture. He wants that moment. Even when they sort of had this like public arrangement that, yeah, you can have that moment, then you're going to have to give up one. Mm-hmm. That was the moment he wanted. And you could see that he was yelling at Dana, and who has the gall, who has the gumption to actually yell at Dana White other than him? No one in this sport. And what are you guys thinking? Are they robbing him of this moment? Did you think that it was like something that was done intentionally?
I'll be honest, for me,
yeah,
I was just reveling in the,
you couldn't care less,
joy, you know. He's a stickler for that, but I did think like Bruce Buffer could have announced it a bit more. I remember I think it was Joe Martinez, he announced when he won the second world title for Cage Warriors, and he did make a point, and for the first time in history, you know, something like that. I thought Bruce could have done that. Maybe he's told what to say, I don't know, but if I'm being really, really honest, I was actually looking for Orla in the crowd, and she got brought into Cage, which I was happy with, and I was just over the moon.
Yeah, you couldn't care less about that.
I was just over the moon.
And maybe they've never done it before. They've never been in this moment. So
yeah, you know, it was a bit of pandemonium. Like, yeah. I think in boxing it's much more common. You'll see them walk in with 16 belts, all these different world titles. For MMA, it is a first, and maybe it caught them. And Dana was saying we were the ones supposed to bring the 145 belt, but that doesn't seem right to me either. Like, you know, like you said, it's the company's worth quite a bit of money.
Yes,
have a few spare belts around.
It's amazing. I love when he brings that up, and he makes the executive so uncomfortable because he mentions these things that no one else has the balls. Yes, and then I mean, this is not your domain, but I'd love to get your thoughts. Like, just the post-fight comments about, I'd like to apologize to absolutely no one. I mean, I really truly think that if he was here before, if he was like a worldwide megastar in sport, he went on a whole other level. To do what he did and to speak how he spoke at MSG is different than Vegas. It's different than Ireland. It's like, you see the celebrity, Madonna's in the front row. This is not something that we've never been here before. And I just get the sense that he's on a whole other stratosphere now. Mm. That's been my in-laws who know nothing. They couldn't tell you a single thing. They're asking me, so who's this Conor guy that won yesterday? Yeah. My neighbor knows nothing. It's a whole other level.
It was a funny moment where I was standing in the corner when Conor walked in, you know, we did our walk in, and me and Dylan are standing in the corner, and his music is still playing, you know, and he's strutting around, and I just catch eye with Hugh Jackman.
Yeah.
Hugh Jackman?
Yeah.
And he's like staring so intently at Conor, almost kind of mimicking him. I just elbowed Dylan and went, there's Wolverine.
Yeah.
It's just such a weird
crazy
moment,
right?
Like, you know, and then, like you said, I saw Madonna and, you know, Gordon Ramsay, you know, is private messaged me and, you know, give him a wave. And
oh, you private message with Gordon Ramsay?
Yeah, we're close like
Does
that.
Does he give you tips?
Dinner tips? Cooking?
Yeah.
No, I'm a
Gordon, cook. I need a lasagna.
I don't have to boil an egg.
Yeah.
Luckily, Orla's a great cook. She spoils me. But yeah, just those moments, which again, I probably wouldn't have taken in any other time, but I did actually kind of have a look around and I was like, holy moly, look, all these people here just to see us throw some punching and kicking,
right?
Like, you know, it's kind of weird.
And then you get to the back. Was it the traditional like whiskey and all that from the Fertitta era, or have Have things changed?
Very disappointed.
What happened?
Very disappointed.
What happened?
So yeah, we go back. It's always like, you know, straight to the medics. That's always number one.
You take your now traditional picture with
him. There you go.
Yes.
I actually said that to my kind of stealing your idea of setting traditions, which is, I think it's a good thing.
Yes. Fiddler on the Roof.
Yep.
Or
So we did our picture, and then a guy come in. He turned out to be a very famous... I think a wide receiver for the New York Giants.
Odell Beckham. Actually, that's his hat right there.
Okay.
You noticed the
hair?
Yeah,
the hair.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, he came in. I actually almost, because I assumed it was a rapper.
Okay.
And I was so close to going, I don't know why I was even going to say this, but I was going to say, oh, you're great. The music is great.
Like, because
I just meet these people all the time.
That's right.
He's a footballer. Connor's actually teaching him the...
He asked him?
The Billy Strut.
Wow, that's amazing.
That was pretty funny.
Why the Billy Strut? I always thought it was an ode to Vince McMahon.
Oh, it is.
But the Billionaire Strut.
The Billionaire Strut.
The Billy Strut. Okay.
Yeah, the Billy Strut. So we're there. He come in. Gordon Ramsay come in. I think someone else might have come in. Anyway, you do your hellos and everything.
Sure.
And then we finish all that. We go back to the changing rooms.
Yeah.
That's usually when Uncle Frank will come in, or Lorenzo. Nothing.
Nothing.
Shared a bottle of water.
Wow.
Very annoyed. Very
annoyed. No Ari Emanuel. No Dana White. None of the new guys.
No. No one came back, no.
Uncle Frank was there, though.
I heard that afterwards.
How about that?
He should have come back and said hello. That would have been
just
really
shy,
cool.
You know.
And he usually has the bottle under his jacket.
Was Conor disappointed?
No.
No.
I don't think he... Yeah, he would. I'm sure he would have had a wee sip, but it was kind of me and Conor's dad, Tony. We were both like, where's the goddamn whiskey?
One of my favorite characters,
Tony
McGregor. It was interesting to hear Conor talk about like celebrity and things like that when he announced that he's going to be a father and saying that he doesn't like, you know, putting your family... Because I feel like Tony McGregor should have his own reality show. And I'm surprised no one in Ireland has offered him one yet. Or maybe they have, and I don't know. Do you know something I don't?
I don't.
Okay. So then he gets to the press conference. And again, it's like, it's a performance every time he does something in front of the public eye. And he announces that he's going to be a father. Was this what was being teased for so long? We had our suspicions, but I feel very strong. Like when I became a father, when my wife's pregnant, I won't talk about this.
Yeah.
I don't understand people who put the picture of the sonogram on Facebook and things. It's a very private thing.
Yeah.
It is not our business. And I was actually disappointed that it was actually put out there first by Dana White to lead to all the speculation.
Yeah.
That's something for him and his girlfriend, and she should not be...
Agreed.
You know what I mean? Why did you think he felt compelled to say it, to tell the world so it could stop?
Why did Conor say it?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, we're getting asked.
It's got to be annoying, right?
Like, yeah. You know, so I'm sure it was just to... Right. Enough of this, you know.
Right.
He just said it. And
do you think he wouldn't have said it had it not been put
out? Probably not. I always say this, and people always like roll their eyes at me. Conor is an extremely private person.
Yeah.
Of course he has this side, and he if he has to do the promotion side of fights, he does. I mean, he does it very well. But find pictures of him.
No.
When there's no fights going on. He doesn't really go out. He doesn't have a massive friend circle. He's not, you know what I mean? Like it's a small, tight circle. And, you know, most of his time is spent just him and D together. And he wouldn't have been into that being announced.
I love that moment. Perhaps because I'm a father, as I mentioned on Twitter, but it was the first time that he actually admitted to being afraid of anything since coming to
terrified.
Since I've known him as a MMA fighter, as a UFC fighter, he's never shown any kind of vulnerability about anything. And now here he is saying in a very like real moment, I'm scared of this. And that was amazing. I thought that was really important. And it showed that this guy is real, that he cares about the same thing that I cared about when my wife was pregnant. Do you get the sense that this is really rattling him?
Yeah. But like you said,
it's crapping me jocks. It's
very good. Very good impression. And it sort of goes to show you how real he is about the other stuff. The Conor has like almost true Tourette's. He can't help but answer the truth, you know. And when he talks about other fighters, that's just him
being
black and white honest. It's not supposed to be anything else other than that. And that was just his black and white honest response to finding out he's going to be a dad.
Gets the month wrong. You know, yeah. It was good that he actually like was sooner than later. If he would have said July,
right.
It would have been like, you're trying to put this off.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's closer to the finish line, at least in his own mind. I wanted to ask him this, but we get blocked out these days, as you may know.
I was surprised you didn't ask the question.
I was trying, but that's a different story for a different day. I wanted to ask him only because I've heard him, and I would have never asked this beforehand, but I've heard him talk about fighters who are fathers and who have a lot going on and you're distracted. And that's maybe some, he talked about this going into the Aldo fight. He's got kids to worry. I have nothing to worry about, just my career. Mm-hmm. That's going to change now. Mm-hmm. What does he have to say about that?
I mean, he did kind of address that, saying he has to experience it. It's a new thing, you know?
Do you get the sense that he's worried it's going to affect his fighting?
I think he has the same opinion about worry as I do.
Okay.
It doesn't really do as much good.
Yes.
But I'm sure he'll wait to experience it.
Uh-huh.
And then he'll make his decision off that, you know? That's how he is about everything. He's pragmatic. He'll feel it, experience it. Gunny went through it. I think it actually just made Gunny stronger.
Yeah.
My good instinct, because Conor's such a tight family man.
Yeah.
I actually think it's going to even make him more dangerous, because now he really feels he's providing for a family.
Right.
You know, and that's a bit in our DNA there. We were supposed to go out and kill the buffalo for the missus.
That's right.
So that's my gut instinct on
it.
What will happen? He'll have to experience it and tell me.
Speaking of gut instincts, so I'm hearing that the return to MSG is currently scheduled for November of next year. That's their next time. Yeah.
So far.
Yeah, right. I agree with that. I wish it was more. Well, they're going to Brooklyn in February, so maybe you have to have a little bit of separation there. But based on his comments, I feel like it's not out of the question that we won't see him for quite some time. Of course, he said this. He said he's going to take a break because he's going to be a father, and I certainly sympathize with that, and I think it's the right call. But I feel like it might be like this idea of him fighting so often, we got a little spoiled of seeing the top draw. Is that a possibility that he doesn't fight for
the
next 11 months or so? What do you think happens?
It's a possibility. I've just learned from my experience with Conor to not make too many plans. Like the 2 a.m. message.
That's right.
Airport at 10. So I know I'm back in the gym this week.
Yep.
I've got two guys fighting on Saturday. Two guys, Artem and Charlie.
That's right.
That's my next move. I don't think he'll be all that long before he's back training, because it's what he truly loves to do. He enjoys rolling and training and sparring and all that good stuff. And then, who knows? Maybe the owners come to him with a realistic offer.
Yeah.
Because it has to be.
Sure.
I don't think anybody that has an inkling about the industry can say he's not being 100% in his right to be demanding a hell of a lot more than, you know, a typical fighter's contract. He's not a typical fighter. Let's see how the numbers do for the next few pay-per-views without him. Compare. You know, I'm an evidence-based guy. I don't really care about people's opinions. I like to see what can be proven. So let's see what the facts show. And I think when they see that over the next few pay-per-views, I think they call him with
sooner rather than later.
Yeah, maybe they want to see how it does pan out. But I mean, everything he touches seems to turn to gold. Every record just keeps getting broken when he's involved. I think I've seen some of the analysts about what they reckon this car would have done without him.
Yeah.
In terms of gate and pay-per-view. And when you see what it does with him, you see that large number and then know that that's not what he's getting. He is right in putting his foot down and saying, well, let them come back to me and let them come back with a realistic offer. And then we'll talk about the next one.
I'm blown away by this idea that they haven't reached out to him yet since buying the company. How is that even possible?
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it? I mean, we're
Do you think they're afraid of him? Honestly.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know who it is, really.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, like you said, Conan O'Brien is part of
it. Yeah, it's crazy.
Is Conan going to call him? And,
right.
You know, does he negotiate the next purse? I don't know. It's going through a strange time. It was always, you know,
very clear,
the quiet boss Lorenzo back in the day. He was the one that did all the big deals. Now it seems to be a conglomerate of stars and celebrities and this big group, like, so I don't really know who it is.
Okay, so this is the question I really want to ask you. So let's say they give him a piece of the company, he's a very happy man, he has a new contract, all that stuff. What's your perfect scenario? Does he fight next at 155? Does he stay at 145? Does he go back and forth? Does he go down to 145 now and shut those guys up? What would you like to be next for him if we get by all the other stuff leading up to that point? Let's just say we're ready to book a fight.
Yeah.
What's your perfect scenario?
155.
Yeah.
That'd be
Do you want him to just stay there?
It would be my choice.
Okay.
But I keep saying it, and Conor keeps, and he keeps raising his eyebrows when people say he can't possibly do. He did 145, you know, less than a year ago.
Yeah.
And like I said, with Lockhart part of us now, he was lighter for this weigh-in 2 weeks out than he would be 2 weeks out from a 145 weigh-in.
Wow.
So it's still there. He still can do it. It's definitely more difficult. Puts a lot more effort in. But just if you're just asking for my little opinion.
That's the opinion.
Mine would be 155.
155. Who do you think is the number one guy there? There's a two horse race right now, right? Habib and Tony.
Habib and Tony. Yeah. Now, I'm going to give you my small opinion.
This is what I want. Yeah. Yes, this is why
I think the second best 145er is Max Holloway. That's my opinion.
Okay.
And I think the second best 155er is Nate Diaz. That's my opinion.
Wow. Yeah. I can hear everyone's mind exploding at this.
I think Nate would beat either Tony or Khabib.
Really?
Yeah. I think he really turned a corner with the Michael Johnson fight. I think we saw a new version of him. And then I think he looked fantastic in both Conor's fights. Conor just bested him. But that's my opinion, my small, unimportant opinion. No need to tweet me your own opinions. I'm not asking. Yeah. He asked me for mine. I'm just giving it. But that's who I think the two best guys are. Now, I understand Khabib is the number one contender, and it's probably going to be him if that's how the company works.
Sure.
But for me, interest-wise, the Nate fight would interest me greater because of that. If it's Tony, if it's Khabib, great. They're two fantastic fighters. A lot to learn in the preparation for them, and both would be extremely interesting fights for me to watch, and problems to solve, and to see Conor being beaten both of them and how he did it would be very interesting for me. But I do think Nate would not comfortably, but be quite a bit better than either of them.
So if I'm putting two and two together here, the fight that interests you most next for Conor is Nate at 155 for the belt.
If I had the magic,
if you were the guy
to press, almost like as a fan, that's the fight that would interest me most.
And do you feel like there is more to prove in that fight? I mean, you got the win back.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's at a different weight class. If this scenario plays out, does this intrigue you enough? Like, and him, because he's talked about being motivated. That's why the Aldo fight. How can you top it? Yeah. Do you feel like there's still more to prove with Nate Diaz?
I'm not sure about prove. I just think for me, he provides the most interesting set of problems.
Yeah.
I just thought, you know, like I said, Khabib, great fighter. I really enjoy his fights. I enjoy watching him and learning from him. And I just thought in the opening 2 or 3 minutes of the Johnson fight, we kind of saw what would happen if he used to face Conor.
He was getting tagged.
He got tagged quite a bit. And I just think that sort of power and accuracy Conor brings, you know, I'm sure Eddie had a great plan until 60 seconds in when he was scrambled. And I don't think it would go massively different if he was to face him. Tony gets hit a lot as well. Super tough guy. Keeps coming forward. Great fighter. I think we'll go that way. The Nate, he's just such a good boxer. I do think if I take away circumstances, the Diaz-2 fight is my favorite fight.
Hmm.
It's the one I keep watching. I keep going back.
Of all time, of all the fights you've cornered?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the all of them have great stories. The Mendes fight is a great story. But just technically, the 25 minutes in that, I learned so much in that. I thought it was a really, really nice fight. Two extremely skilled strikers. I don't think Nate gets nearly enough credit for how good he is. And I just think with his jiu-jitsu, incredible guard, incredible guillotines, incredible triangles, if the likes of Khabib or Tony was to shoot in on him, because they would be getting lit up in the feet, I think he would finish them.
Were you guys in the arena when Khabib got on the mic?
No.
Did you see it afterwards?
I saw it. We were leaving the apartment. I did actually see it.
And what was your reaction? I mean, he's talking about Ireland versus Russia. He's calling him a chicken. I mean, that was, I don't know if you're a pro wrestling fan, but that was like an old school pro wrestling heel promo.
Oh, okay.
That's how you get everyone. I mean, to go in that environment, to start speaking in Arabic and Russian, to start calling the guy a chicken. I mean, the only thing he didn't do was spit on the ground like the Iron Sheik back in the day. I was just wondering what the reaction was to that.
I thought it was great.
Yeah, okay.
You know, I thought it was brilliant. That's what you want. You want this interest, you know.
That's what Tony didn't do last week, right? He just said, peace, I'm out of here. And no one got emotionally invested in
his
journey.
Yeah, you have to kind of get that way, don't you? Even when I thought when Aldo, you know, won and Conor was there, like, it's not in his personal. I don't think you should pretend to be somebody you're not.
Yes.
But he did just kind of fade away instead of, like, you know, I don't know.
Of course.
Again, you shouldn't act like someone you're not. And I respect that. He is not that person. But It does. It puts bums on seats, you know. And I thought Khabib did a great job of getting the crowd going and you know getting interest in that fight. 150 million versus 6 million.
Yeah.
But it's only 1-on-1 on the night.
That's right.
But I get his point. I know what he's saying. You know, it'll obviously be a massive amount of interest from the Russian audience.
Sure.
And Conor's, I think Conor's biggest fan base is actually Russia.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like my book is getting translated into Russian.
Really?
Yeah. Because there's such
any other languages?
Hungarian.
Weird.
Bizarrely.
Why?
They're just the two countries that have bought the rights. So
wow,
Hungary apparently I'm big in.
Have you ever been there?
I flew through there on the way to my sister's wedding in Rome. I spent a day there, but no, I've never.
What about Russia?
I've been Ukraine.
Yeah,
is that Russia or something?
Old Russia.
Old Russia, yeah.
Yeah.
But never like to Moscow or
right.
Petersburg. I'd love to go. I think it's a fascinating country, fascinating people. But yeah, I know that was obviously Khabib's point. But
and you know what people are going to say, and you know what he's going to say, right? You're avoiding the wrestler now.
Of course.
Right?
We've been avoiding the wrestler from day one, apparently.
Yeah.
Then it was the, what was it, when he beat Mendes, when it was the full camp wrestler.
Sure.
Now we go up a weight class. One of the toughest grinding style wrestlers that there is. He went to, you know, he smothers people.
Mm-hmm.
And look how the fight went. But, and I said this, and I've always said this after all his fights, I would hate if he did a fight and everyone went, well, that's that done.
Yeah.
It has to be questions. There has to be intrigue. There has to be the, now it's the Russian wrestler or you know, the, I don't know, maybe if you call Tony the more submission guy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the American jiu-jitsu guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But there'll always be, you know, it'll be, well, what about a full trained, full camp Jedi Knight? You know, there is always going to be that what about, which is brilliant, which is great. It's why he's generating the numbers that he is, because there is this interest to see him against different people.
There's an outlet in Ireland. I think it's, there's so many newspapers in Ireland, Irish Times, this, that. One of them, a fan tweeted me today saying that according to their source, he's close to retiring. Is this bollocks?
Yes. I love how you say it. Leading bollocks here.
Is it?
Load of me bollocks.
Has he ever brought up the idea of he's 28, right? He's
28.
He's making money. As he said, he doesn't get hit.
So rarely gets hit.
Right.
I think that fight, I don't remember a decent shot landing.
Right.
Anything that does is usually just moving away from it. You know, and you look at look at Romero. I mean, he looks absolute stud. He's 39.
Yeah.
He's like, what, 10, 11 years older than Conor. And Conor has very little miles on the clock. I would be more surprised than anybody if he was to retire.
And then you go to Marquee, the infamous Marquee, right? On Saturday.
Oh, God.
What was that like?
The less said about that, the better.
I saw some videos.
I'm like a drunk uncle at a wedding.
It's an amazing, I love it. I love when you guys are put in that. I mean, he's very comfortable, even though he's wearing the suit. His dad is there. You guys are just having, and all eyes, it's like you guys are animals at the zoo, right? Everyone's just watching you.
Yeah, I don't know what it is about the States. Like, they can't really organize.
Is it a mess?
VIP party. Like in Vegas, it's always hell because they put a string here.
Yeah.
And then everybody has to stay on the outside of that. And then we're here. But there's a string keeping us apart from 2,000 drunk people.
Sure, sure.
You just crowd in. Maybe Americans are more polite or something and they see the string and they go, oh, don't cross that. But Irish, you just kind of come in. And, you know, I was like, okay, maybe New York is different. Maybe they understand how people separated. And we went in and it was absolute nuts. So I actually stood up in that because I was getting crushed, like literally getting crushed.
I thought you just wanted to be seen.
No. Maybe a little bit.
Yeah.
I was trying to like tick all the boxes. I was like, all right, goddamn, I'm going to go to the VIP party.
And this is Marquee. This is a very famous place.
Is it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
This is like, even I know about Marquee.
Oh, okay.
And I'm not a club goer.
Right, right.
Does a part of you kind of hate it? Or are you, because you don't seem like a club goer yourself.
Yeah, no, I really, you know, even Orla was saying to me, God, it's not like you to be.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I'm just going to lose myself. I'm going to just take one night. And a few of my students were there and they were kind of looking at me going, who's this? Who's this guy? And I'm trying to rap at them and everything. It was hugely embarrassing. But yeah, I just trying to, like I said, just really lose myself.
And you kept the Reebok shirt on.
Actually, one of my fighters said to me, that's when you know you've made it. When you get into a club like this wearing your tracksuit.
You didn't even change.
No, I went, because I mean, what time did we leave at? It was
right.
Half two, 3 o'clock.
Oh man, it was late, yeah. It was
very, very late. Yeah. So by the time I go back all the way to the hotel, I get changed, everything, I was like, I really thought we were going to walk in. And like they said, I think we got there at 3:45.
Okay.
And he said at 4 was closing, so 15 minutes. So I was like, all right, 15 minutes, we walk in. do that, you know, get a few cheers. I'll have one whiskey because we didn't keep our tradition. Me and Omrod, he said, we're going for one whiskey.
Yes, yes.
4 o'clock came, and then suddenly they were like, oh, let's just keep going.
Oh, man.
And then I was on my second whiskey, and I got a little bit looser, and then suddenly it's 6 a.m. and I'm rolling around the carpet.
What happened there? I see you have some marks on your arm.
I don't know if you can...
I only noticed it because you lifted your arm right there. There it is.
That's what happens when you challenge Conor's wrestling coach, Sergey, to a takedown match in your hotel hallway.
Wow. At what time is this?
This must have been 6 o'clock, I guess.
So now you're back?
So we're back.
Does he challenge... So he... Like, are you guys...
It was so funny. Like, I remember we're just kind of walking towards the door. And we had, you know, all our gear. And I said, I dropped the gear. And just Conor walked in. Was it after?
No, you were doing it to get a whiskey.
Well, it was like the winner gets a whiskey.
Oh, wow.
Ah, okay.
You really wanted that whiskey.
I guess we both had one.
Yeah.
Anyway, I just said, all right, Sergey, let's go. And as I was saying, all right, Sergey, he was taking off his jacket already.
Oh,
so
man.
He sensed it. I think rappers always do this. You get a few drinks and then we have to roll. Like,
yes.
I think anybody who does jiu-jitsu or wrestling, we're probably not ahead to that. And I got thrown violently on my head.
Really? How long did this last?
I don't know. I got him with the armbar on the ground.
You did? Okay,
in fairness to Sergey, he's the wrestler. I'm the jiu-jitsu guy. So Dylan said it was pretty weak going.
Oh, was he there too?
Yeah, he was kind of. Did you see the video? No, he wasn't there, but he saw the video. Conor took a video of it. Hopefully that.
Conor's actually standing there doing the Tyron Woodley and filming.
Yeah. Well, he said afterwards, actually, it was. Well, coach, we got a knockout on an armbar tonight.
and like, did you actually get hurt or is this?
No,
okay. Is this where people are sleeping?
Like, I think we're like banging into the hall.
Did anyone come out?
I apologize to anybody. We woke you up. I'm normally the guy in the room going,
these
God
idiots.
Sake, these idiots.
Yeah, yeah. I would have loved to see someone like open the door and then see Conor there and you, like an Irish fan who's in town and then probably join in on the fun. So what time did you go to bed on Sunday morning?
Half seven. Oh, yeah, because we went in then, and then so a fan had left in a bottle of single malt, and me and Sergey got into that.
So oh, wow.
It was a late one, an early one.
And what is the day after like? How do you come down from that high? How do you possibly like go to bed and have a normal morning sleep? You know what I mean? Like, there's so much adrenaline. There's so much built up.
Yeah. You know, like, maybe the image people have of what happens is different, but it turned into just... I think it was me, Orla, Conor D, and like pajamas, like lounging around the
house. That's it. That's how it ends.
it gets ordinary fast. And then last night we all had an early night because everybody's pretty tired from
before.
And then today.
Unbelievable. So when you dreamt of it, when you wanted it, when you pushed for it, did New York live up to your expectations?
More so.
Exceeded.
More so. And I had that day here 3.5 years ago where I put up that picture and I really didn't like it. I didn't like being here. It reminded me of London or something. It was too packed.
Okay.
Walking from one block to the next block, I just kind of bounced or elbowed off people. I'm not really into that. This time I loved every moment of it, every day of it. New York is a special place. And I think we came at the perfect time weather-wise.
Oh, yeah.
It's not too warm, not too cold.
Well, you actually got really lucky. It was unseasonably warm.
Got really lucky. And, you know, it's obviously great having Orla here. And the rest of the day now, we're going to see the Statue of Liberty and Freedom Tower and all these things. So it's an amazing city. There's never a boring moment. There's never a time where you can't do something. Any food you want, any entertainment you want, you know, 24/7. I feel like I'm working for the New York Tourism Board.
Yes,
here.
It's good.
But it's I'm sure that's why you moved here. You know, it's a special city.
And then you go from riding in Rolls Royces and all this attention, and now you're going to Belfast, and it's not the same treatment, but you care just the same. Is there any shift like, okay, the spotlight isn't on us? I'm sure in a weird way, it's kind of... It's appealing, like, okay, like you can just go back to the nuts and bolts of what you do as a coach, getting your guys ready. You have one guy who's making his debut. You have another guy, Arnhem, in a very important fight. Like, to do that back to back, is that a weird thing for you or is it a seamless transition?
I'm every weekend doing this. I'm at some show or another. Like, on the 12th on Conor's fight night, I had another guy fighting in Northern Ireland, Kieran Clark, a fantastic amateur, big future ahead of him. And I was sick I couldn't be there for that, you know. But that was on the same night. Unfortunately, he lost by decision. few little small mistakes to fix in his game, but he's got a bright future. Next week is Belfast, and then we have the big Bama card coming up in Dublin. But
that's right.
Small amateur show with one fighter to the bigger shows. I just love fighting. I love seeing two guys fight and what way the techniques are going to work, how the strategies are going to work. And it doesn't really matter to me too much.
And let me put a pin in this. The welterweight stuff, is that possible? Like the Woodley stuff, is that even on anyone's radar? Is that a viable option at all?
I know I'll get ripped apart.
Okay.
On Twitter for this as well. But
please.
I don't see why not. I don't see why not. I don't know. Maybe it won't happen. And we've got so many irons in the fire at this stage.
Sure.
But I don't see what other people are seeing. Like, there's no way Conor could touch this guy. There is. No one's perfect, you know. And there's openings there. Of course, it's a bigger man, and he's more power, and you got to be super careful. But Conor trains with big guys like this. I see him do pretty amazing things in the gym all the time. So if he was to say to me tomorrow, say, that's it, foot's coming down, I've got the green light, we're fighting Woodley for the belt, I'd be like, okay, let's go.
Wow. Yeah. No reservations.
None.
Wow.
What's the worst that can happen is he loses.
Right. But as a matchup, you kind of like it.
I just think he's just a man. He swings punches. I watched him against Thompson there and he did very well.
Yeah.
You know, great win. He toughed out some. I thought Thompson was a little bit better at kind of like the, if it was scored like an amateur boxing belt, like, you know, kind of like points.
Yeah.
Woodley did the better damage, clearly. But when I looked at it, I was like, okay. He's not enormous. He's not some Goliath man, you know?
Right.
He's a little bit bigger. But Conor would have reach on him and he'd have technique on him in the striking for sure. He'd have to, of course, deal with that. But I'm sure power, anyway, we're kind of going into strategy.
Yes.
But I certainly don't, in my head, go, oh my God, no. We couldn't possibly beat him.
Wow.
It's like, it's a doable fight.
You guys like history. You like making history. Three belts. Holy smokes.
Sure the haters would love that.
Yes. Let's end on this, because I've taken up enough of your time. You have a lot of sites to see. So what are we seeing? We're seeing Statue of Liberty, so everyone can follow you to the places. Oh, yeah. Give us the itinerary. So you can have a crowd of Irish people following you. I wonder if probably most of them went home at this point. It's probably nice that...
I've actually seen quite a few.
Oh, really?
Even walking here today, a lot of people stopped me on the street, and it's been really cool. So it's probably today, I'd say most are going home.
Right. Okay. What was your favorite moment of this past week? I mean, is there a moment backstage that's... And by the way, I have to ask before, you wrapped his hands while he was still wearing his suit, which is a very Rory McDonald thing to do. It's a very sort of like American Psycho thing to do. Like, yeah, you're going to fight, but you're still in your business attire. Has he ever done that before? Is that a normal thing? Because I don't recall him looking
like
that.
Yeah, he was just kind of like... Like, Conor is obsessed with fighting as well. He just loves fighting. It doesn't matter who it is.
Sure.
He just watches it. And he was sort of engrossed in the card, because when we arrived, was the Edgar fight just ending? I'm trying to remember the run of things, or maybe the first of the main card, the girls, maybe they were just starting.
Okay.
But since the minute we arrived, he's glued to the TV. So he still had everything on, and then he took his jacket off, and then he's watching all the fights, and then suddenly we're about three fights out, which is not that close. It's getting close enough. And he still hadn't even changed yet. And I was like, okay, I'll just do your hands while you're, because he's kind of watching and he's shouting at the TV what they should and shouldn't be doing. And then I said, look, I'll put the chair so you can watch the TV, but I'll sit in front of you. So, he's kind of like this. And it was actually quite hard wrapping his hands because he kept like reacting. And I was like, just hold still for a minute there, will you? So that's kind of just how it happened.
Wow.
Just that he hadn't got changed yet. And I was kind of wary of the time.
Sure.
It's
an amazing sight, though, to see a guy, we know him as a fighter, but he's still wearing his suit, getting his hands wrapped. Incredible to see that. By the way, any injuries? Like the hand, the foot, anything?
He said actually is, I don't know whether he hit him with the right hand, but something happened that he felt like just fixed. I don't know.
Don't tell me. I was just going to say, it actually gets better as the fight, like it goes back into place.
Something like that. He said he doesn't feel anything anymore, so I guess.
And he was feeling it up until the fight.
I have a thing where I always I move his joints around his fingers before I wrap his hand, but I avoided those two fingers because I didn't want to inflame them. So,
right.
I mean, I think 48 hours out, actually when he was doing the workout with Owen Ruddy where he like he hit it then and he hurt it again then.
Wow.
Yeah. He just kind of jarred it on Owen's body when they were grappling. So yeah, it was definitely there right till the end.
Amazing. Okay, so let me get, but now it's okay and the foot's okay.
Perfect.
Wow. What's a moment? Being backstage, seeing something as a, you know, a historian, so to speak, of combat sports and appreciating the moment. What's the moment that you're going to tell your kids about, your grandchildren about? What do you think is going to stick out from this?
I have to be honest and say, like on the first drop, I knew what way the fight was going because it just confirmed to me that there was this gulf of difference between the two of them. And a tiny bit started kind of like going,
oh man,
whoa, let's take it in, you know, because wow. I'm just glued. And I just felt it's like me watching him in the gym with someone that I'm usually going, hey, Conor, take it easy. But now I don't have to do that.
Anymore. Right.
You know, he's doing what he wants. So from that moment on, I kind of felt this is, I know what's going to happen. It's the writing's on the wall here. So probably that first drop, it was like in my head, I could see the two bells on him.
Wow.
And I was like already thinking, how will I get Orla into the cage when this is over? Because I knew where she was. I'd seen her in the crowd. Actually, that was a pretty cool moment when I saw like Wolverine and then just looking through that sea of people.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I saw her waving and I had no idea where she would be. And then suddenly I just saw her and I was like, oh, hey, Orla, in the middle of this.
It's the hair.
Yeah, it probably was the hair. Might be something else.
the connection that you
the connection have, that yes. was it yeah so yeah it was kind of funny from that moment on I was sort of like a little bit celebrating in my head which I would not recommend anybody
do. Yes
terrible coaching terrible mindset but it was I can't deny it
did you speak to your parents after
my mom rang me yeah she rang me
how did they do with the time difference
badly.
Okay.
My dad didn't last. He's terrible.
Oh no.
10 p.m. at home. He's yawning. So I think it was a 6 a.m. walk back home. But my mother, fair play to her.
Yes.
Kept at it. And
at the pub or at home?
No, the police stopped the pub.
They don't keep it open.
You see, he was just between you and I.
Yeah.
He was kind of illegally open in the bar that late.
Oh wow. Okay.
So he got, they kind of knew he was doing it, but they're sort of turning a blind eye, but this time they were like, okay, just don't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Neighbors
yeah.
are complaining. So they had to watch it at home. And my sister watched it in her home. She had tickets to come over and she got sick.
Oh, no.
The week of the fight, had to cancel her flights. It was a disaster. Hope you're feeling better, huh?
Yes.
But they were kind of, you know, she's in her house, my mom's in her house, and they're kind of messaging each other. And I'm sure it was like, you know, great, great moment. Yeah, so I just rang my mom and her voice was gone and she was, you know, so proud. And my dad gets on the phone there and, you know, I think for any man, especially Irish, when your dad gets on the phone and says, son, I'm proud of you.
Wow.
Kind of like, you got to catch your breath. Yeah. You know, I think he said it to me 3 times in my life. So it was
wow. Not even the Aldo Federer. This is the time that he was proud.
Dublin one.
Yeah, Dublin.
Know, and then this one. And maybe when the book came out or something.
So. Right.
Sparring with them, but then I know they mean something.
So amazingly, like up until your 40s, your dad has never said I'm proud of you up until like the last year.
I might be slightly exaggerating.
Sure,
probably
sure.
When I got my degree, he said it.
Right.
I'm sure he said it a few times, but it never hasn't lost its power.
Sure.
It's always nice for your parents to be proud of your achievements. So actually that was the first thing my mom said, because there's a story years ago when one of my gyms failed. It was actually just after Conor joined many, many years ago, and I got a letter saying I had to get out. The unit wasn't suitable for a gym because there was forklifts going around, and I couldn't find another gym, another suitable unit. And I brought my dad to look at this unit, and he was like, no, that won't work here. And I dead serious said, I guess I'm going to have to get a real job. And my parents found this the funniest thing that they've ever heard. But I just meant I'm going to have to go into a 9-to-5
job. Sure, sure. Wow.
And my, you know, my dad's laughing, and I was like, what's so funny about this? Then I went on, I got the long mall gym, so it worked out. But my mom, when she picked up the phone, she goes, hey, are you going to get yourself a real job now? You know? So that was the first thing that
they always remember that stuff, parents.
Oh, my parents loved that. Yeah.
How long ago was that?
It was literally, Conor had just joined a few months.
Wow.
And I got this, like I said, I got this letter saying I shouldn't have been in this unit. It was only for light industrial work, not for commercial gyms. And I guess it's around about close to 10 years ago.
That's amazing.
About 10 years ago, yeah.
Now look at you.
And
King of Dublin. You run that town. You can evict people and say, I'm starting a gym right here. Maybe a restaurant too.
Yeah.
What are you expecting when you get home, by the way? What kind of reception do you get?
You know, I think there's like there's a lot of things online, like the ticker parade.
Yeah. But where's that?
It's actually like I don't think Conor will want any of that. That's the funny thing. Everyone thinks it's like the government isn't doing this for us.
They offer it.
Well, the last one there was talk about it. I don't want to get it wrong now, but I'm almost certain it was there if you wanted it. But Conor's a private person.
Sure,
he's not
sure.
Really into that. So. Will it? Maybe it'll happen this time. I don't know. Like, I think he should do it.
He should do it, you know, of course.
He should do it. He's earned it. He deserves it. It's a fairly unique achievement. But there's still a little bit back home. Like, one of our rugby team is doing fantastic right now.
Yes.
And one of our best players, Jamie Heaslip, he's fantastic. And he tweeted out about, like, is Conor Ireland's greatest sports star now? And he got tore apart on it because you have all these people that, hey, that's not even a sport, you know.
Oh my.
So we're still in that era back home, you know. We're still not quite there yet.
Wow.
So I think the government, a lot of the officials, and I've been in meetings with these high up ministers when I was starting the MMA association and talking about, you know, commission and all this kind of stuff. And a lot of them are like, we really like Conor.
Yeah.
Could he sign this for my son? But then I think, well, it's still a sport to be regulated. You know, they can't quite be seen to be a fan just yet, but it's he's hard to ignore.
Yes, certainly. And the PR that he does for the country like we talked about last week, we don't have to get into it again, but I mean, you see these people out here and I was thinking of you a lot, how confident they were. You know, a lot of the Conor fights leading up to it in Vegas, the funniest thing about the Irish fans, they always come up to me kind of nervous. They're like, is he going to win? Tell me. Like, I know the secret, you know, like I've already seen this movie. I didn't get that as much this time. Mm. It was almost like, when's he going to win? What's he going to do?
Yeah.
So it was exactly to your point last week.
That and just the absolute fanaticism with the tricolor now and national pride. Like, I don't remember seeing that 10, 15 years ago. And now, like, people are proud to be Irish.
Yeah.
Of course, not only him, but he certainly played a role in this. So he should be celebrated at home, and we should be very proud of him. I am.
Well, again, congratulations. I could go on forever, but I'll let you to it now. And it's going to be hard to top this, personally. I mean, to have the back-to-back in-studio interviews, the tradition is fun, but it's not. I mean, sometimes the Skype doesn't work. It's grainy and stuff. This is going to be hard to top, but I guess it's fitting for such an historic event, a memorable one. Congratulations. Enjoy it. Job well done. Good job calling it as well. 4 seconds off. You know, we won't talk about how it went, but you got the number right. And that is an amazing thing. Wow. Unbelievable. I'm sure you're getting a lot of people asking you for lotto numbers, predictions, and things like that. But no one deserves it more than you guys. So again, congratulations. Enjoy the victory. Enjoy your time here in New York. And then good luck this weekend. Charlie Ward and Artem Lobov fighting in two very important fights on that card.
Mm-hmm.
So enjoy it.
Thank you so much.
Yes, all the best. There he is, John Kavanagh, the head coach for Conor McGregor. Now, the only fighter in UFC history to hold two belts at the exact same time. He is the featherweight and lightweight champion. Who knows? Maybe 170 is next. Maybe 135 is next. Who knows? Maybe that one's a little tough with the weight cut. But what a ride it has been covering him up until this point. Can't wait to see what he does next.